Automated arm movement is a big deal for custom animation. It allows you to be more expressive during performance, as your attention is not solely on a character control. Today we will review how to track your arms so you can act live in front of the camera without fiddling with buttons or controllers. We'll need to get a lot of pieces ready, so let's start with the wrist and work our way backward. There are 5 wrist zones. 4 of them are on the outside if we move the arm around the elbow, plus the one in the center. As we move in the arm, we need to flip the wrist based on the arm position. We will do it with a swap set in the character animator. If we navigate to rigging, we can see that the most of the wrists are inside the same group, plus we have the separate one for the center wrist. We bring it all together inside the same swap set. Swap set itself has a MIDI value assigned, so make sure to use the same values if you don't want to adjust the code later. I'm using 1 for the wrist in, 2 for the wrist mid, 3 for the wrist out, and 7 for the center wrist. In the motion tracking mode, we can see the dot responsible for the wrist rotation. In order to rotate the arm, we use the dot at the base of the wrist, and we use the dot at the tip of the middle finger, so we can basically see a line, and it's gonna be tilted based on our wrist rotation, so we can wave. At the moment, only one arm is ready, which is good enough for proof of concept, but we'll keep working on that. Additionally, we will not call it left arm or right arm, because it's getting kind of confusing as we're rotating the character. Instead, we will use the near and far based on whatever arm is near. And it works well in majority of the situation, but sometimes the character isn't just in the front view. In this case, we will imagine that the character is rotating counterclockwise until the one arm becomes near. And in case you are wondering, we are working with a near arm in this case. After we're done with that, we can work with the transform behavior for the wrist. Just go ahead, find it, add it to the control tab, and we are ready to rotate and scale our wrist. Scaling for the wrist is required to make an impression that the wrist is coming closer to the camera. So make sure to go to the scene, navigate to controls, go to layout, and drag to the scale, scale X, and rotate to your controls. Scale and rotate controls are self-explanatory, and scale X will require for later. Set up rotation to the range you like, so your wrist looks okay in all extreme positions. Finally, we have the central wrist. When the arm is coming to the center, we swap the wrist to a center wrist and remove the forearm altogether. Next, we'll look on the elbow and forearm. We need to have a transform behavior that is similar to the wrist. Please ensure that rigging dot is positioned appropriately, and if you're not sure how to do it, refer to this video, how to design your arms for animation. We'll need to go back to the scene control and add the rotation and scale X to the layout. Rotation will be used to rotate our arm around the elbow, so rig it with appropriately positioned dot, and scale X will be used to scale our arm on the X position, so it can shrink as we come into the center. Ensure to rig your minimum and maximum values for rotation to make a full circle, and minimum and maximum values for scaling, just whatever feels right for your arm before it looks weird and overscaled. Last thing that we want to bring up here is the control from the previous step. You remember that we added scale X for the wrist? This is where we need it. When we use scale X to transform our forearm, it will also transform our wrist, and we will use the scale X control for the wrist to offset it. So as we are shrinking our forearm, we can increase the wrist. And we can do it by assigning the same MIDI value to control the both controls. In order to trigger scale X for our forearm, we use the distance between the wrist and between the elbow dot. And as they are coming together, we understand that our wrist is ready to be swapped to the mid-wrist, and we are ready to get rid of our forearm. But before that, we scale our forearm to be smaller and smaller. The last part left to cover is a shoulder. In your case, you may not have a swap set here, but I have fairly distinct looking elbows, so I do. And in this case, we will need to make sure that the elbow can look in, can look out, and can be disappearing because the arm is looking forward. We will also need the transform behavior, and transform behavior here will be exactly the same as a forearm. Scale X control here is quite interesting, as it allows us to do something weird with an arm. Let's flip to the motion capture. Pay attention to the elbow dot and the shoulder dot. usual of movements really leaves a distance between them fairly static, so we can use it as a trigger. As the elbow dot is coming closer to the shoulder dot, we can understand that the arm is really reaching to the camera, and we can use it in our animation. The problem arises when we have to control all those transform behaviors independently, because it's kind of hard and a lot of things to do. And this is where the motion capture and automation comes in. That part concludes the character animator side of things. We have the MIDI values assigned to all the in, out, and mid, and they are all the same for both shoulder, forearm, and wrist, because we want to swap them all at the same time based on our movement and where our body is. The last thing for today is running the code. It's not the easiest thing to do if you've never done it before, but nothing too scary. If you're stuck somewhere, let me know in the comments. Let's start by downloading a few things. Go to this site, download Anaconda, install it, open it up, and run something called Spider. After you're ready with that, go to the GitHub repository and open this file with a Spider. The big pieces that we use here are MIDI simulation and MediaPipe project from the Google. MediaPipe is easy to use, you pretty much run it and it tracks your body and give you access to the joints that we are using. As we are grabbing these joints, we're taking the outputs and passing them as a MIDI signal. For the MIDI signal, we use RTMIDI library. If you are using different MIDI values from what I used before, here is a list where you can modify it. I dragged it all to the beginning of the code, so it's easy to set up. When you're done, you'll be able to press play and the program will start with the body tracking. And in the next videos, we will dive deeper into how this works, how do we record, how do we replay, and how do we adjust the performance along with the various different tricks. We'll also work on reliability and recording functionality specifically, because Adobe Character Animator does not allow us to do much when we already recorded the MIDI values, so we will have to do our adjustments before we record. Alright, this is a nice long video, so don't forget to make a call to action at the end. Cheers.